Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Would you just join with me and let's prepare our hearts and open before the Lord in prayer. You can stay right where you're at. Let's just honor the Lord today. Father, we thank you for the opportunity that we get to be here, Lord. First and foremost, we thank you for the blessings that we have here in this house, that we get to come on a fine night such as tonight in an air-conditioned building, Lord, with lights and with sound and video and all the different pleasantries that we get to have. Lord, we get to come into this house and freely worship you, Lord. How blessed we are that we get to do so when people around the world are dying and being persecuted like we can't even imagine, just to hear the name of Jesus. Lord, thank you so much for all that you've blessed us with. We don't come into this house and take it for granted because we come for tradition, because we come to hear from a particular man, from our favorite here, from this person there, from the older, from the young. Lord, we come into this place to hear from you, and we acknowledge that here at this house that it's Jesus Christ that's the senior leader of this church. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask that your Holy Spirit would be our counselor, would direct us and lead us and guide us into your word, into your truth, that we would look into your word and realize and adopt your way for our lives, Lord, knowing that we would live a blessed life as we live after you. And Father, we thank you for all that you've done for us here. We don't ever think of ourselves as better than anybody else, but Lord, we know that we are co-laborers, workers together in the body of Christ, working together to build your kingdom for your glory. So Lord, we ask that you would bless all of the churches across the Inland Empire tonight that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, all the different various denominational churches, the churches that are not affiliated with denominations like Harvest and The Grove. Lord, we thank you for churches like Sandals and Water of Life. We ask that you bless Emmanuel Baptist and Victory and Trinity. Lord, we thank you for all the various brothers and sisters. Lord, we know that we cannot reach this Inland Empire all by ourselves. But Lord, you have placed us strategically here with our brothers and sisters to tell somebody about you. And Lord, we thank you that you give us the opportunity each and every day. So Holy Spirit, speak to us, minister to us, lead us in your word and in your ways. And Lord, to you we'll give the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said amen. Amen. Well, last week I started a little series. I didn't really quite know it was going to be a series, but I'm here tonight and I figured, let's continue on the subject. Last week we started a series called The Attitude of Gratitude, talking about living a life of gratitude towards God, because ultimately God's desire, God's will for us, I don't know if you knew this or not, because I think sometimes as you look or as you watch other people around the world, sometimes I think people just don't quite understand or quite know that God's desire for you and for me is to live a blessed life. Did you know that? God's desire for you and for me is to live a happy and a fulfilled life. Did you know that? God's desire for us is to live a life full of joy and gratitude, that we would walk around and be a shining example of God's goodness and his glory to the world to see. And last week we learned and we saw that, an attitude of gratitude is something that we've got to see because it's God's will for our lives. And we learned some very simple things, and just as a matter of recap, if you didn't hear it, that's okay. You can always go online and check it out online, or you can get a CD, I guess, if you'd like, or we'll just recap it tonight. But we learned that gratitude defines our attitude. When we live a life of gratitude, it defines our attitude. The question was, have you ever seen an upset, grateful person? I mean, think about it for a moment. Have you ever in your lives and your travels and your journeys throughout the course of your life, have you ever just seen somebody that is just absolutely so raging mad because they are so grateful for something that happened? No, because gratitude defines our attitude. And when we live a life that is grateful for what God has done for us, grateful for what God has given to us through Jesus Christ, a life of gratitude to God, it begins to define our attitude in this life of depression or this life of anxiety or whatever it might be, the tensions that we go through, we see begin to take the back burner in our lives because we have an attitude that is grateful to God, and people begin to see that. But we learn that gratitude must be genuine. God's not looking for manipulative prayers. Have you ever been in that place where maybe you thought, if I thank God for something, he'll give it to me? God, thank you for. And then all of a sudden it's like, well, we learn that gratitude has to be genuine. God's not looking for the words of our mouths. He's listening to the prayers and the words of our heart. And our gratitude to God must always be genuine for the genuine gift in Jesus that he gave to us. But we learn that our gratitude's not based on the present circumstance. How many of you guys know it's so easy to forget? Have you ever forgotten what somebody did for you? Has somebody ever done something great, something amazing? I mean, something that's just out of this world and you just over and above what you could think. And then all of a sudden, a couple of years later, you forgot what they did until you were reminded. It's easy to forget. Why? Because life continues to move. It progresses on. But you see, our gratitude is not based on the present, on the present blessings of today. Our gratitude is based on the grace of God. If you recall looking back at our subject scripture, if you want to turn there, we can go back there again today to 1 Thessalonians in the 5th chapter, verse number 16, 17, and 18. Very short scripture, section of scripture, very familiar verses for you and I. Bible says to, go ahead and put it up on the overhead for us, guys. It says to rejoice always. God's desire for us is to live a life of rejoicing, to pray without ceasing, constant communication with God. In everything, give thanks. Why? This is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. See, God's desire for us is to live a life of gratitude. And those words, rejoice, and the word give thanks in the original Greek language. Remember, I told you about those words. Those words, literally the root word, the foundational word in which those words are built upon is the word charis or grace in the Greek language. Why? Because our rejoicing, our gratitude is based on God's grace. His divine ability to get the job done on our behalf when we can't do it. Beginning with our salvation. We're saved by faith through grace, through God, and we didn't deserve it. God's unmerited favor in our life. If that's the only thing that ever happens to us in our lives, we live a life of gratitude for that, because that alone is good enough to live a thankful life. Thank you for that dismal applause. Amen. You see, we live a life of gratitude to God's grace because He did something for us when we didn't deserve it. But you know, life has a way of happening. This last week I had the privilege, one of the great parts of pastoring is celebrating in the high moments of people's lives. I remember I was out in Los Angeles and I was buying a suit. You know, you say, you own a suit? Yes, and I wear it for the best and the worst of occasions. That's what the salesman said. And when I asked, he asked me what I want. I said, I want a black suit. And he says, you want a best and the worst suit. And I said, what's the best and the worst suit? He said, you wear it to weddings and you wear it to funerals. It's for the best and the worst occasions of life. As a pastor, one of the greatest things that we get to do is we get to partake and share in the high moments of people's lives. And I had the wonderful privilege of marrying one of my people in my young adults ministry that I had the opportunity to raise up and to see and just watch them flourish. And so they're entering into a new season of their life. And I was there with her and her husband, and we were talking in the office. And it was kind of funny because he didn't understand. He didn't know me like I knew him or like I knew her, the bride. And so we were talking. He says, man, it seems like you're trying to get us to fight. So I looked at him and says, listen, I know it seems like in my office as we're talking, as we're conversing together about what goes on in a marriage relationship, I know you think that here I am sending you out after today's little appointment that you might get in a little argument with your fiance. But the truth of the matter is, I told him, here's the deal. I'm not here to counsel you, to talk you, to lead you through the good times of your life. Why? Because none of us need counseling when life is good. Amen. But I said, the problem is that you're going to have trials. You're going to have fights. You're going to have arguments in your relationship. You're going to have turmoils. You're going to have hardships that you didn't anticipate coming your way. And if you don't know how to handle those in the hard times, what you do in the hard times of your life is what defines your future and how you come out of this. So I said, we're here. So it may seem like I'm told him, I said, it may seem like I'm trying to get you to fight. And the reason you may think I'm trying to get you to fight is because I want you to think about what you'll do in hard times. Why? Because hard times come our way. We live in times and seasons. The Bible tells us there's a season for rejoicing and a season for weeping and crying. There's a season of sowing and a season of harvesting. There's a time of waiting, like Pastor Jim talked about today. There's seasons of our lives. We can't escape it. We can't deny it. We can't run from it. All we can do is continue to live life through those seasons. And oftentimes what happens is there's seasons of turmoil in our lives. There's seasons of tension. Maybe something's going on in the family. There's some tension at work. Maybe the future economic outlook, if you look at the news, it seems like it's getting more negative and negative. There's seasons of uncertainty. I don't know the answers. I don't know what's going on. And confusion in your life. There's seasons of crisis. Crisis in health. Crisis in character. Crisis in relationships. There's these seasons of hardships, of seasons of things that come against us, that come our way, that are hard to endure. You know, in these seasons of tension, in these seasons of turmoil, in these seasons of uncertainty, in these seasons of crisis, it is so hard, if not seemingly impossible, to be grateful, to have an attitude of gratitude, Because we focus on the problems. We focus on the pain. We focus on the hardships. We're focusing on what's going on so that we can get out of this as fast as we can. Lord, let me learn from this problem today so that tomorrow I can return to your blessings. It's hard to be grateful. It's hard. Sometimes it seems like it's impossible. Pastor Luke, you don't understand the crisis that I'm going. The doctor just told me that I'm terminal. How can I be grateful for that? How about the parents that have lost children? No parent should have to endure the losing or the passing of one of their children. But yet, Pastor Luke, how in that moment can I be grateful? What do I have to be grateful for? But you see, gratitude, when we understand what gratitude is, gratitude is not walking around with a smile on your face, bubbly, doubly. Everything, if there was ever a way in my life, I wish I could be like Dennis Harworth, who's over there smiling, because he knew it was coming. If I could live a life like Dennis, to be happy, to be bubbly at all times, I wish I could. But you know, naturally, my personality tends to be that glass is half empty, which means in my own life, in these seasons of turmoil, in these seasons of tension when it comes to family drama or children drama or work drama, whatever it might be, with my natural aptitude to look at the glass as half empty, it doesn't come natural to me to be grateful, to rejoice, to sing out in these hard times. But you see, God has a desire for us to not just endure life, to not just make it through this season the Bible calls as a vapor time, this test tube of mortality, so to see where we would go for eternity. God's desire is that you wouldn't just endure. God's desire for you is that you would thrive throughout your life. And that's why he says, rejoice in everything. To pray without ceasing. Don't ever leave your communication with God. I forgot to talk to God this month. No. And always to be thankful, because this is the will of God for you. Paul says, church, the will of God is for you to have a joyous life, to have a life of communication with God, and most importantly, to have a life of gratitude, to remember the price that was paid for you and for I. If nothing else, if in my season of turmoil, if in my season of tension, if in the time of uncertainty in my life, or in the crisis that I'm enduring, if nothing else happens, I can be grateful because Jesus Christ died on the cross for me 2,000 years ago. That God demonstrated his love, that while I was still a sinner, he poured out his blood and his body to be broken for me. A life of gratitude. Why? Because gratitude defines our attitude. But it's not just about walking around and being smiley and bubbly. There's more to gratitude than that. Why? Because gratitude does more than just define our attitude. Today, that's where I want to take us. I want to look at what else gratitude does for you and I in these seasons of tension, these seasons of turmoil, these seasons of uncertainty and unrest, and in these seasons of crisis. Because I believe when we understand what the Bible says about these in our areas of our life, we get a clear picture. And here the thing is gratitude. Gratitude produces peace. Gratitude produces peace. Last week we learned that gratitude defines our attitude. Have you ever met a mad, grateful person? No. Think about it like this then. Gratitude produces peace. Have you ever met a panicked, grateful person? Somebody that's walking around, oh my goodness, oh my goodness, oh my goodness, like running around like Chicken Little. Oh, the sky is falling. What's wrong with you? I'm so grateful. No, it doesn't happen. Why? You don't meet panicked, chaotic, grateful people. Why? Because gratitude does something. It creates in us a reflection of the gift, of the blessings, of what's been done for us. And you have to sit in that moment of gratitude and just think to yourself, man, I'm blessed. Man, I'm good. Man, I can't believe what has been done for me. I remember a friend of mine for my wedding, my Stacy and I wedding, we got all these wedding presents. I talked about birthday presents last week. I'll talk about wedding presents. I remember a friend of mine gave us an iPod. And you think, okay, that's cool. But it was like when iPods first came out. You remember when iPods, do you remember CD players? Do you remember cassette players? Man, I went to a restaurant in Bishop the other day, or a couple of weeks ago, and they had an 8-track player that you could put at your table. And my little nephew, my little brother-in-law, he's 14 years old. He's like, what is that? Is this a VCR? It's like, oh. It was like the first iPod, the very first. I mean, it was a big deal if you had an iPod. It had a color screen. And I remember he got it engraved with our name, and it was the biggest capacity one you can get. And I just remember for years thinking, oh my gosh, everybody else got us like really cool presents, but this guy spent like hundreds of dollars on our wedding. I never forgot that. I was so blessed. And every time I thought of him, it brought me back to that. Man, this guy went out of his way for me. It didn't produce this chaotic desire in my life. It rather brought this calming and this stillness on the inside of me to know, man, somebody loved me. Somebody cared about me. Somebody cherished me. You see, gratitude, when we give it to God, when we reflect on God and to reflect on what God has done for us, it does something on the inside of us. It produces peace in chaotic times. You know the scripture. It's a familiar scripture. I'll put it up in the New Living Translation. Philippians in the 4th chapter, verse number 6, says, don't worry about anything, but instead pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for all He has done. Why? When you experience, then you'll experience God's peace. When? When you thank God. When you go to God. When you reflect on God. Then you'll experience God's peace. Some of you are in this place today and you need peace in your life. You say amen to that one. Pastor Luke, you don't know what my home life is like. I need peace. Pastor Luke, you don't know what my life is like. I need peace. Pastor Luke, you don't know what my health is like. I need peace. I've got turmoil. I've got tension. I've got uncertainty. I'm going through crisis. I need peace. And here Paul exhorts the church, listen, don't worry about anything right now. Focus on God and let Him know what you need. And when you do, give it to Him in thanks and in gratitude. And a grateful heart produces peace. Because all of a sudden, everything comes into alignment, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your heart and your minds as you live in Christ Jesus. That word guard is a military term. Think of a prison guard. A prison guard determines what comes in and what goes out, which means the peace of God will determine what you allow in and what you allow out of your heart and of your mind to begin to change the circumstance around you. Because gratitude produces peace. Because all of a sudden, something begins to happen. You see, gratitude produces peace because all of a sudden, we begin to change our perspective. As a matter of fact, when gratitude defines your attitude, it begins to change your perspective. Last week, we talked about gratitude defining your attitude. And when gratitude defines your attitude, it begins to change your perspective in life. We're panicked, we're stressed, we're pressed, like Paul says, hard pressed on every side, stretched and afflicted, but I'm not crushed. Why? Because my perspective is changing. I'm not focusing on the issue. I'm not focusing on the turmoil or the tension or the uncertainty. I'm not focusing on the hardships of my life and the crisis, but now I'm focusing as a grateful heart by offering up to God the praise that He deserves, because thanksgiving is a form, praise is a form of thanksgiving. And so when I give to God the praise that He deserves from a grateful heart, it begins to change the perspective of my situation. And I begin to see things a little bit more clearly because I'm focusing on the solution and not on the problem. Look what the Bible says in the book of Isaiah. Go ahead and put it up on the Bible, Isaiah the 26th chapter. You, God, will keep us in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on You. You see, gratitude, whenever I think of that iPod, whenever I still have it, the battery's so dead it doesn't turn on, but I still have it. It's in a drawer. I can tell you right now in my house where it's at. When I think of that gift, I always go back to that person, and I think about that person. And I think about how they spent their hard-earned money on me that day. When you come to God with a heart of gratitude, God, thank You for what You've done. God, my life seems like it's falling apart, but thank You for Jesus. God, my health is deteriorating, but thank You for the gift of salvation in my life. God, I'm going through a crisis, but thank you for the grace that you've given to me, that your strength is made perfect in my weakness. And we come to God with the attitude of gratitude. It begins to change our perspective in life, and our mind is fixed on the solution and no longer the problem, and our situation begins to change. Because gratitude produces peace. Church, God wants you to know. His desire for you is to not live a life of stress. Man, it's amazing what stress does to our bodies. I remember when I was a kid, we'd go to the doctors for whatever, this or that. I'd get hives or a rash or whatever. And the doctor would just say, it's probably stress. I thought it was a cop-out. I thought it was just like, man, the doctor didn't want to do their job, so they just blamed it on stress. Stress does all sorts of things to our human bodies. God's desire is that you don't live a life of stress. That when you endure tension, that when you have times of turmoil, seasons of uncertainty and areas of crisis, God says, I don't want you to live a life of stress and worry and chaos and panic. I want you to live a life of peace. This is the will of God for you and I. God wants us to realize that when we give to Him our praise, when we give to Him our gratitude, Lord, thank you. Lord, thank you. Lord, thank you for what you've done for me thus far. All of a sudden, our life begins to pan out in perspective, and the problems get little because the solution is always bigger than the problem at the moment. Solution is keeping our eyes, our hearts, our minds fixed on God. God wants you to live a life of peace. Live a life of blessing, of success. His desire is not for you to be beat up by the storms of life, but rather to stand on the rock of Jesus Christ, to go beyond them, so that when the sun shines, you can say, I have endured through the grace of Jesus Christ. So what do we do with this? Pastor Luke, I'm glad that you've brought to me the notion that gratitude produces peace. Great, wonderful. What do I do with that? How do I do that in my life when I'm going through turmoil, when I'm experiencing crisis, and I have questions in my heart that can't be answered and haven't been answered, and I'm waiting and I'm waiting and I'm waiting. What do I do? I believe today the simple gist of all of where we're at today in finalizing and summarizing this series of the attitude of gratitude is that when you feel like panicking, praise God. When you feel like panicking, praise God. When tension sets in, when turmoil comes your way, when uncertainty settles in your mind and those questions that you have haven't been yet answered and your mind begins to race and you focus in on the problem and the pain and you trying to figure out what can I do to get rid of this and how can I get beyond this season and I got to figure it out and I got to get out of this, I got to get out of this, I got to get out of this, and all of a sudden tension and stress settles in, when you feel like panicking, praise God. Praise God. Because gratitude produces peace. Praise is the result of a grateful heart. To lift up to God the praise that He's worthy of. To praise God through your turmoil, through your tension, through your hardships, through your uncertainties. You know, God does something so amazing for preachers. You know what God does for preachers? He makes preachers live what they preach. I tell you, you preach a message on gratitude, God's going to give you an opportunity to be grateful. And an opportunity to be grateful does not come, let me tell you through experience, an opportunity to be grateful does not come with a beautiful sunset. Well, Pastor Luke taught on gratitude, so God gives him a sunset, and oh Lord, I'm so grateful. No, tension, turmoil, uncertainty, crisis comes your way. All of a sudden, your natural tendency, my natural tendency this last week was a tough week for me. I can't even say why. Spiritual attacks. I come home and I come to my wife and the first thing I do is vomit all over her all of my emotions and my panicking. Well, I got to do this, we got to do this, we got to make a plan and this is where we're going. And oh my God. And she's just like. But when you give it to God, When you give it to God, God, I don't know the answers. God, I don't know the result. God, I don't know what you have for me tomorrow or around the bend, but I know that I have Jesus, and I'm going to praise Jesus because he died for me, and if nothing else, I'm good for the rest of my life. All of a sudden, perspective settles in, and the problems that were so big, were so life-changing, necessarily don't seem to be as big as they once were, because God is always bigger. You remember the story in the Bible, maybe you don't remember the story in the Bible, but there's a story in the Bible about a young man named Daniel. The story is Daniel in the lion's den. Anybody remember Daniel in the lion's den? Daniel was a leader in the kingdom of Babylon, and there he was, and they brought him in. See, what they were doing at the time is these conquering kingdoms, these Syrians and the Assyrians and the Babylonians and the Persians and so forth and so on, what they would do is they would take their conquered lands and they would bring people of affluence, people of position out of the conquered lands, and they would bring them and they would indoctrinate them into their society, into their ways, so that they would be influencers of the people, so that the people wouldn't rebel against their conquered kingdom, but now they would adopt and come into line. And so here's this young man with other young men of Israel and of Judah, and here they are, and they've been brought into this kingdom, and the king is trying to indoctrinate his ways, his diets, his plans, their gods, their beliefs, their systems. And yet Daniel does not waver. His three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they do not waver in what they do. And so here, God begins to bless Daniel. And the people around Daniel become jealous, envious. They have aught against him in their hearts because Daniel is a man of character and a man of integrity. And so they go to the king and they say, "Oh, king, live forever. We want to challenge you, king, to make a decree because we think that there are people in your kingdom that don't serve you and that aren't loyal to you, and we think you ought to make a decree that nobody can pray to their gods. Nobody can seek their gods, but they must pray to you and to your gods, and you are the great ruler." So the king says, "Well, that's not a bad idea, actually. I kind of like that." So he signs it into law. And look what the Bible tells us in Daniel, the 6th chapter, verse number 10. The law. When Daniel knew the writing was signed, when Daniel knew that the law had been written, when Daniel knew that the king had just signed that he could no longer pray or he would be tossed into a lion's den, that he would be executed for his belief and for his stance, and now he was faced with turmoil. Do you think that there's a little bit of turmoil knowing you might face a lion's den? You think there's a little bit of tension in your relationships when people are stabbing you in the back? Do you think there's a little bit of uncertainty not knowing what will happen at the lion's den? How about a little bit of crisis when your life might end in a moment? And here's Daniel living in this moment, realizing that his sight or his fate has been signed. He goes home. What does he do? In his upper room, with his windows open, towards Jerusalem, he knelt down on his knees 3 times. Look what it says. And prayed and gave thanks before his God, as was his custom in the early days. You see, Daniel was accustomed to living a life of gratitude, and it brought perspective to him. Daniel didn't panic. He didn't freak out. He didn't go to his upper room and say, "Oh my goodness, what am I gonna do?" He got down on his knees, and he went before the Lord, and he prayed to God. And he thanked God for what God has done for him thus far. And then when the king came to him and when they brought him and they caught him praying and they brought him, Daniel says, "My God will deliver. I'm not worried about the lion's den. I'm not worried about what goes on." And the king says, "Man, Daniel, I like you. I hope your God delivers you." You know the story. They throw Daniel in. They shut the door to the lion's den. And the king was so upset that he was tricked into to executing Daniel, that he couldn't sleep, he couldn't eat that night, and he got up early in the morning and he went to the lion's den and he said, "Daniel, please tell me you're there." And Daniel says, "God, my God, has brought an angel to shut the mouths of the lions. I am here today, alive." Daniel wasn't destroyed in panic. He wasn't wrapped up in turmoil and tension and chaos and crisis. Daniel had a perspective because of his gratitude to God, knowing God would deliver him. You see, all my life, because of my nature, because I'm that glass is half empty. Dennis, I envy you, my friend. My parents would always tell me, my dad would always tell me, Luke, stop making mountains out of molehills. Stop making mountains out of molehills. What does that mean? It means that I take a little issue and I focus on it. I focus on it. I think about it. I stew about it. I dwell on it. I try to figure out the solution over and over and over and over. And I take a magnifying glass to it in my heart. And the magnifying glass isn't big enough, so then all of a sudden I take a microscope. And the microscope power 10 is not big enough, so then I put it to power 50. And it's not big enough, and I put it to power 100. And all of a sudden this minute issue in my life has become this gigantic mountain that I must face. Church, stop making mountains out of molehills. Some of your molehills are huge. But when you come to God with an attitude of gratitude, praise and gratitude brings peace. And when you feel like panicking, when the world is crumbling around you, when everything's falling apart, when you feel like panicking, praise God. Praise God. Glorify God. Because that's the moment God's power comes into work in your life. And perspective begins to change. Bible tells us in the book of Corinthians, I thank God that he has given us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. He's talking about death. You don't have to be afraid of death. The wages of sin is death and separation from God. But God gave us the victory over that separation through Jesus. Therefore, if we live a life of gratitude, everything else falls into place. Because when I feel like panicking, I will commit to praising God. Remember, praising God is not false. It's not this lip service to God. God's not after your lip service. God's after your heart. Praise to God doesn't have to be bubbly and overjoyous and dancing and singing. Praise to God is simply acknowledging God for what he's done. God, my life has fallen apart, but thank you that I'm still here. God, I've got turmoil in my life, but thank you that there's breath in my lungs right now. God, there's a crisis going on, and I don't know what the answer is. Thank you for your grace, because I know that you have given me victory through Jesus Christ. And that gratitude produces peace, and peace brings us to praise. And when we feel like panicking and we praise God, it takes our perspective and stops focusing on the problems of our life, and now we begin to see the solution, and the solution in Jesus Christ will always, always, always be bigger than the problems that we face. Nobody needs to tell you that God wants you to live a joyous life. Nobody needs to tell you that God wants you to live a life of peace. Nobody needs to tell you that God wants you to succeed through life. But today, in your hardship, in your turmoil, in your uncertainty, in those questions that you have that haven't yet been answered, in the tensions that you face at your job, with your family, in your relationships, wherever it might be, in the crises that life brings to us, or whether they're financial or whether they're health or whether they're relational, whatever they might be, God wants you to have a life of peace. God wants you to have a life of joy and rejoicing. You see, you may not need anybody to tell you, but we have need of people to tell us God loves us, that God is bigger than our problems, and that God's desire for us is to live a successful and a joyous life, and it comes by giving a life of gratitude and praise to God. So when I feel like panicking, when I feel like giving up, when I feel like venting, when I feel like letting it all go and giving it all up, praise God. Praise God for what he's done for you. And watch the perspective come upon you, because gratitude produces peace. Last week I had you think of a scenario. Now I said none of you had that scenario, so just think of somebody else. This week, you've had the scenario. Think of this, just go with me for a moment. In a scenario in your life when something has happened, Maybe you're in a season of pleasantries right now and the sun is shining, or maybe you're going through a storm. But go to a scenario in your life, a time that you went through when you reacted and you responded and you operated in fear. How did that situation go? How did that scenario play out? Looking back, they say hindsight is 20/20. You look back and say, man, if I would have done this, or if I would have done that, if I would have only known this, I would not have had to have acted, or not would have said those things to my wife or to my coworkers. I wouldn't have lashed out because I was afraid. I wouldn't have stepped out, or I wouldn't have quit my job, or I wouldn't have done this because I didn't think I could handle it anymore. How would that situation or that scenario, how would it have gone differently if you would have given praise to God and lived a life of gratitude to see the perspective of God in hindsight, that God is always there for you? You see, God doesn't want us to live stressed, wrapped up in our problems, in our turmoil, in our chaos, in our crisis. God wants us, like Pastor Jim talked about today, to live a life entangled and wrapped up in Him. And gratitude brings us to a position, to a place that we are literally wrapped up and entangled in the ways of God. A knot so tight I can't get out of. Why? Because I'm so thankful that no matter what happens in my life, God is my everything. And when God is my everything, it doesn't matter if everything else happens. I've got God on my side. And if God be for me, who could be against me? If God be for you, who could be against you? Some of you are enduring some hardships, some trials in life, but just remember, gratitude produces peace. There's a story in the book of Acts, the 16th chapter. Paul the Apostle and his cohorts are there teaching and ministering, and they heal they cast this demon out of this sorceress or this girl who's telling the future, and the owners of this slave girl are making money, and they throw a fit, man, you took my business away, and they throw Paul and Silas in jail for this, and here they are in jail now. We think of jail. We think of, you know, a cot, maybe the color orange and a serial number and bars. We're not talking about 21st century jail. We're talking about first century jail. Not good. No running water. No exercise breaks. You know, they didn't have really nice cufflinks that they got to wear. They were in stockades, locked hand and feet, bound. The Bible says in Acts, the 16th chapter, that Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns. That's a time of turmoil. That's a time of tension. God, you wanted me to minister, and now I'm in jail. God, you wanted me to be an example, and now I'm persecuted. It's a time of crisis. Their backs were split open by canes and rods after being beaten. God, this is a terrible situation. And I have nothing to be grateful for, because it's midnight and my hands and my feet are locked up in a stockade, and I'm hungry and I don't know what's going to happen. But yet, they were praying and singing hymns to God. But that's not just all that happened. And the other prisoners were listening. That's the key. The other prisoners were listening. You know the story? Great earthquake comes. It must have been a really cool earthquake, because it was the kind of earthquake that breaks jail doors off of their hinges, and it's the kind of earthquake that undoes stockades so that everybody's free. That's a neat earthquake. I've never seen an earthquake like that yet in my life. I've only seen the kind that knock pictures off my wall. But yet this great earthquake comes. And the prison guard awakes from his slumber, and he sees that all the doors are open and all the stockades have been released in this earthquake. And he pulls out his sword, and he's about to fall on his sword. Because prisoners who are in turmoil, who have tension, who are going through uncertainty and in crisis in their situation, have just been freed. Logically, what would you do? Run. So he's about to fall on his sword to kill himself, because he knows that his responsibility has been left out, and he knows the consequence will be his death. And there in verse number 28, they shout out to him, "Stop! Don't kill yourself! We are all here." We are all here. Church, people may not, we talked about this last week, people may not accept your gratitude. The fact that you can't shut up about what God has done, they may not like you for it. They may persecute you for it. They may look down on you for it. They may speak negatively of you for it. They may say that you're bubbly and fake and all the different things, but you know what? You don't do it for them. You do it for God. And they may not like it. They may not accept it. They may not appreciate it. But they cannot deny it. They cannot deny it. And because Paul and Silas were singing and praying to God, and everybody else heard what they were doing, they could not deny that God had just delivered them. You see, the peace that God's desire for you to live in is not just about you. It's not just about me. It's not just about my life that I can endure the 80 years that God's given to me here on earth or maybe more. It's about the people around me. Because there are people watching you. There are people examining you. There are people looking at you, watching to see if the gratitude that God desires for you to express is genuine and if it really does produce peace, but they cannot deny it when it happens. And we don't do it for others. We do it for God. But in doing so, others see it and they catch it and they realize that God is always in control. God's plan of the ages for his church is for us to be the shining example of God's glory for the outside world to see. And it comes when we live a life of peace through tension, through turmoil, through uncertainty, through crisis. When they look at us and they say, I don't know, I don't appreciate it, I don't get you, but I cannot deny the fact that there's something about you that I don't seem to have. All of a sudden, the picture gets bigger. The perspective begins to show itself because gratitude produces peace. When you feel like panicking, when life comes at you, when the waves rage and the wind roars, you feel like you can't go any further, praise God. Praise God. There are far too many people in this world that walk away from Jesus Christ during the hardship because their perspective is focused on their problems. When God says, I'm so much bigger than your problems, I just wish that you would focus on me. Colossians 3:15 says this, let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your hearts. For as members of one body, you are called to live in peace, and always be thankful. Amen. God's desire for you is a life of rejoicing, communication with God, and a heart and an attitude of gratitude, because gratitude defines your attitude. You won't be mad when you're glad. If gratitude and when gratitude defines your attitude, it brings perspective, and now all of a sudden, gratitude produces peace. So, church, when life comes at you, and you feel like panicking, praise God. Praise God. Let the peace of God that rules in your heart guard your heart and your mind, because God's desire for you is a life of peace, not stress, not tension, not turmoil, not uncertainty and questions unanswered, and certainly not crisis, but a life of peace. Did you guys get something out of the Word of God tonight? Amen. Listen, before we leave today, I want to just take a quick moment. Now, it's an intimate night. It's not quite the large and the booming Sunday night that we're used to. And it's Labor Day weekend, and everybody's out traveling and vacationing and stuck on the Interstate 15 right now, but you are here. I don't know all of you. And it would be a shame for me to leave tonight, to end the services and to conclude under the assumption that every person in this place will find God on their own or is in the right position right now with God. You see, the Bible tells us that as the people of God, as people here, we ought to examine our lives from time to time. And I want you just to take a quick moment with me and examine your life. And I want to ask you a question, very important question, yet a very simple question. And the question is simply this: if you were to leave today, heaven forbid this be the case, but by way of looking into your life, if you were to leave today and you were to die, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? It's a simple question. And you see, how you answer that question or how you come about the conclusion of your answer has a lot to say about your position and your place with God. Today I want to talk to you about that. Because we live in a society that's created all sorts of different avenues and all different sorts of paths and thought processes in which we might think that we're okay with God, when really the Bible is very clear and concise on what we must do and how we must be. So let's talk about that today. Say, well, you know, I'm not sure about that heaven or hell. I'm undecided. I haven't quite landed on that. I just don't believe that God would send, a loving God would send people to hell. Listen, God's not in the business of sending men to hell. As a matter of fact, the Bible says that Jesus Christ didn't come to condemn, but he came to redeem. You see, God's in the business of not sending men to hell, but redeeming men to heaven. So it's not about whether or not it's real or doesn't, or I haven't seen it, I haven't felt it, I don't know about that. Listen, it's about you taking a moment to realize that there are things in this world that are in operation that you cannot see, you cannot feel, you do not understand, but yet they're working right now. Like the radio waves from me to the sound booth. You know that they're going on because you can hear the sound of my voice through the speakers, but yet you don't see them, you don't feel them, you don't operate in them. Heaven's a real place, real enough for God to speak about it, real enough for Jesus to teach us about it, real enough today for us to take it serious. It's not just some wishful thought in our lives, some utopia that everybody arrives at their own place. You see, it's the position of paradise with God in his presence. God's very clear and specific on what we must do. You know, oftentimes what happens is we think in our minds, well, I think I'm going to go to heaven. I ask people that a lot, and that's probably the greatest answer I get. Well, I think so. I hope so. Man, I want to. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can think, that you can hope, that you can want your way into heaven? You don't get to heaven because you think so, like the little train, I thought I could, I think I can, I think I can. No, God's not looking for that. He's not looking for your positive outlook on life. He's not looking for your fact that you can see the glass is half full. He's after something more than just your positive thoughts, to live a good life. We say, oh, well, Pastor Luke, here I am today. I'm in church. I attend church on a semi-regular basis. I go to on Christmas and on Easter. I came today with some friends or somebody invited me, or I found myself here today. I sit in church and I hear the pastor preach, and people who go to church go to heaven. But did you not know where in the Bible does it say that people who go to church go to heaven? That because you sit and hear the pastor preach, because you heard some words and you clapped and you said amen and you raised your hands during a song, does that mean that you're going to get to heaven? Nowhere in the Word of God are you going to find that those are the things that get you to heaven. Yet we think that all we have to do is go to church, take a membership class, have a card in my wallet that says I'm a part of an organization or a member of a church. All we do is, well, if I get involved and if I serve in the children's ministry, the youth ministry, if I sing in the choir, it's real easy. All I got to do is be an usher. Listen, did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're an usher, because you're active, because you're involved, because you helped out, because you carried the pastor's Bible, or even because you were a position of leadership in a church, that means you're going to get to heaven? You can't find that in God's Word. Why? Because that's not how we get there. Well, but Pastor Luke, all my life, my parents told me that I was a Christian. Growing up, I was raised in a godly home. My mom always took me to church, and I believe in God. And I professed all my life to be a Christian. When the census came knocking on my door, I marked the Christian box. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you've given yourself a title, because you've called yourself a name, it's only used two times in the Bible, Christian? Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you've given yourself that name that you're going to get into heaven? Nowhere does it say that because you got a cross around your neck or a St. Crucifix or St. Christopher or a crucifix, or nowhere does it say that because you've got a Jesus tattoo or a scripture reference tattooed somewhere on your body that you've made a proclamation. You can't give yourself a label and expect that to be good enough. God's looking for something more. Well, but Pastor Luke, I'm a good person. Good people go to heaven. I've done more good in my life than I've done bad. You know, I had a couple of bad years, but I've been working really hard at getting rid of those. I've worked on changing my habits and doing this and doing that. That's great and that's wonderful. But did you know that nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you're a good person that you're going to get to heaven? Yet so many people in America, so many people in this world think that all they got to do is be good, because their parents probably told them as a child that they're good, they'll go to heaven so that their parents can get a break. Well, listen, did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you give to the Red Cross, because you help out your fellow human being, because you try to do good more than you do bad, nowhere does it say that you're going to get to heaven? You see, God's standard for entrance into heaven is perfection. But there's a problem. The Bible does say about you and I that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Each and every one of us, in our own life, in our own ways, has fallen short of God's standard. So therefore, we can't get to God our own way. We can't get to God because of our thoughts, because of our wants, because of our religious affiliations, because of cards in our wallets, or because of our outward services. God's not looking for you to buy your way or work your way or earn your way. And God says, I want you to accept your way. And the only way we can get to God's heaven is through his way, Jesus. Jesus said that I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one goes to the Father except through him. Today, I want to give you that opportunity. Jesus in the book of John, in the very same chapter, the very same conversation that we get, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. That same conversation, Jesus is speaking to a religious man, Nicodemus. A man who memorized scripture, a man who gave to the poor, a man who did all the right things and said all the right things. And he's talking about the subject of eternal life. And Jesus says that in order to inherit the kingdom of God, to see the kingdom of God, you must be born again. What does that mean? Well, you know, you hear that word, you think of born again, you think of what Hollywood and the internet and society's made it out to be. Well, that's that weirdo, out of control Christianity. I don't know about that. But really, born again, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, has always meant the same thing in the heart and in the eyes of God. It means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. You see, it's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. God's not after your mental assent or your carnal knowledge of who he is. Listen, you can scarcely go anywhere in America and find somebody who does not know who Jesus is. The Bible even tells us that the devil knows and believes that Jesus is the Son of God. But did you know that just knowing who Jesus is not enough? God says, I want all of your heart. I want all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through his Son, Jesus Christ. And today I want to give you that opportunity. Let me show it to you in the Bible, in the book of Revelation, the very last book of the Bible. Jesus, in his final plea to the churches here today, to you and I, to believers, to people who follow after his words, he says, you think you're doing everything great. You think you're rich. You think you're wealthy. You think everything's good, but you don't realize how naked and how destitute you are. Oh, I wish, he says, that you would come to me and buy from me that which has been refined in the fire. I wish that you would be clothed with the robes of righteousness. See, God's saying, I wish you would stop doing life your way. Stop trying to do things your own way, because your way is not my ways, God says. And Jesus says this, as it says, I'd rather find you hot, I'd rather find you cold, he says, because if I find you lukewarm, I'd vomit you from my mouth. It's a shocking statement, but what Jesus is saying is, listen, I'd rather find you in, I'd rather find you out, I'd rather find you all the way, one way or the other, because if you're lukewarm, you're not really, you're good for nothing, not doing anything, and be rejected and ejected from the kingdom of God. What is a lukewarm Christian? A lukewarm Christian, what does that mean? It simply means that in your relationship with God, it means you've got your ups and your downs, and your ins and your outs, occasional church attendance, doing some of your own thing, doing some of God's thing. Doing, you know, church every once in a while, doing church on Sunday, but then Monday through Saturday, you're kind of doing your own thing. Listen, God says, I'd rather you be hot or cold. I love you enough, I respect you enough, I honor you enough, even if you discount everything I say because I'm offending you right now, but I love you enough to even tell you the truth, even when it hurts, that you're not going to make it when you do it your way. You're not going to make it based on your thoughts, based on your hopes or your desires. You're not going to make it based on your actions or your church attendance. The only way you're going to make it to God's heaven is God's way, and that's through Jesus, by giving him all of your life and all of your heart. The Bible says that the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. It's a gift. And like any gift, you have a choice to accept or to reject. When somebody gives you that birthday present, you can take it back or you can keep it. See, God's not a manipulator. He's not going to force his way or make his way in. He's not going to kick down the doors of your heart and your life and say, here you are. He's going to say, it's your choice. Because I've already given Jesus to die on the cross 2,000 years ago for you and for me and for my sin and for your sin and for my shame and your shame. And he says, now the answer presents itself, and it's your choice on whether or not you will accept the gift of God through eternal salvation. You know, the thing is it's not even so much about what happens when you die. You know, that's so important. Eternity is so much bigger than the life we live right now. But it starts right now in life. Because Jesus said these words. He says that I have come that you might have life, and that you might have life abundantly. Some of you are living in this place in a state of emptiness, in a fog, doing life your way, and you're tired of it. You've tried to fill the emptiness on the void on the inside of you with people and relationships and positions and money and material things, but yet no matter how hard you've tried to fill, no matter how thirsty you seem to be, you can't quench that thirst. Why? Because it's a God-sized hole. Jesus says, come on, come to me. Drink from the waters of life. Accept me into your life. Give me that position in your life and I will fill you. You'll see abundance. You'll see a fulfilled life. You'll see a life of purpose, no longer of emptiness. And some of you are in this place today and it's time for you to stop doing life your way and to start doing it God's way. Jesus says that if you confess him before man, he'll confess you. If you deny him, he'll deny you. The decision is yours. In a moment, I'm going to do something real simple. I'll count to three. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'm going to go three. And I'll smack my hands together real loud. Bang! And when I do, I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're making a decision. You're saying, I want to give God my heart. I want to give God my life. I'm tired of living the way I live. I'm tired of doing the things that I do. I'm tired of living under this pretense or this assumption. I want to give God my heart. I want to give God my life. You see, I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it, and you can put it right back down. Pastor Luke, if I raise my hand, I'm going to be embarrassed. I'm not going to embarrass you. And even if you were, wouldn't it be better to spend a moment of embarrassment than an eternity in hell because you couldn't go forward for God in a warm and welcome and loving place like the church? If you can't do it in the welcoming aisles of a church, what makes you think you'll do it in the real world outside of these walls? It starts by making that decision today. Who should raise your hands? If you've never given your heart, you've never given him your life. If that's you, in just a moment, get ready. If you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child or in the youth group. Maybe you went to a Harvest Crusade with Greg Laurie and you prayed that prayer once before, but you never really followed through and something never really clicked within you. You prayed that prayer before on a TV with a TV preacher, or maybe you've been living your life going to church in and out all the time, living a lukewarm life. Listen, if that's you today, today is the day of your salvation. You're here right now for a reason, for a purpose. You've had doctors and dentist appointments. It's a divine appointment for you now. Between you and God. Don't let anything distract you from this moment. It's time for you to come home, to accept life, to accept purpose in your life by giving Jesus your heart and giving him your life and making that decision today. So when I count to three all across this auditorium from the side to the side, from front to back, even the people in the family rooms, you guys in the family rooms, I can see you through those glass windows. If you're outside watching on the television system around the campus or even at home, or out on the road, wherever you're at, watching by the live stream, wherever you're at, this is your moment, this is your time to accept life in Jesus Christ. So when I count to three, if that's you, get ready. Pop your hand up, I'll see it, I'll acknowledge it, be proud about it. This is the best decision you can make, and it's time for you to start living life for God, making that decision. You ready? I'm gonna count to three, and when I do, if that's you, get ready, pop your hand up, I'll see it, I'll acknowledge it. Here we go, ready? One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two, three, four, five, six. Six wise people. I got you guys over here. Seven, eight, nine. I got you guys right over there. Nine wise people. Ten, I got you right over there. Anybody else in this place? I see the ushers pointing over there. I see you right over there. All right. 11. Man, you say, man, I wonder if I should. You should. Something's speaking to you, drawing you, coming at you. The Bible says no one can come to the Father unless the Holy Spirit draws him. If that's you, don't reject that calling right now. 11 wise people. Anybody else in this place today say, man, I wonder if I should. You should. This is your moment. This is your time. I'm going to close it up right here, right now. Anybody else? Well, let's praise God for 11 or so wise people. Awesome. All right, here's what we're going to do. Now, all of you who raised your hand, that's great. You made a decision. But you know, and I know, every decision, if it's going to do something in your life, requires action. You don't get saved by raising your hand in church. You get saved by making Jesus Christ the Lord and Savior of your life. And we're going to do that together. We're going to follow through and act on that decision together. So here's what I'm going to do. If you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, maybe you didn't, but you know you should have. I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. If you came with your friend or you came with a family member, look to that person and say, come on, I'll go with you. Or look to them and say, come on, will you come with me? I want you to get out of your seat, get into the chair, and come meet me here at this altar, and we're going to change destinies together. So let's all stand. If you raise your hand, all 10 of you, 11 of you, if that's you in this place, come on, get out of your seat, get out of your chair. Come meet me right here at this altar, right here, right now. Let's change destinies together. Wherever you're at, if that's you, you come. That's you. Come on, you come. Get out of your seat. Get out of your chair. This is your moment. This is your time. Come and live forever. He'll give you life everlasting. They're still coming. We'll wait for you. You're worth it. He'll give you strength. Well, hey guys, praise God, you came. Couple things. First and foremost, maybe you never had somebody tell you. Maybe you never had somebody encourage you. But somebody's got to tell you the truth. You're doing a good job. Good job. Good job. Way to go. Good job. You see, you're making the greatest decision you could possibly make as a human being. Choosing life in Jesus Christ. Everything is going to change today. Good job. Congratulations. You're not going to a funeral. Not going to the morgue. You're going to a birthday celebration. Today you're going to be born again. The rest of your days are ahead of you in Jesus. And I'll tell you what, God is going to be so good to you. I want to do some things. I want to do something with you. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name is Pastor Joel. Like, you know, Noel and Christmas? Joel, really cool guy. Like this guy a lot. Here's what he's going to do. He's going to take you guys just right over there. Listen, nothing weird goes on. I'm about as weird as it gets at this church. I promise you've made it through me. He's going to take you guys just right over there and do a couple things. First and foremost, he's going to lead you in a prayer. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You get saved by inviting Jesus into your life to be your Lord and Savior. Lord and Savior, what does that mean? How about leader of your life? You're inviting him to come in to be the leader of your life. Second thing he's going to do is he's going to give you some free information. We don't want you to leave here empty-handed. We want to hook you up. So we're going to give you a little book that my dad wrote, Pastor Jim wrote, just called Welcome to Your Destiny. Very easy reading to help point you in the right direction so that when you walk out of this place and you say, what do I do next? We're going to set you on the right path. The third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back. He's going to introduce you to a friend, a spiritual personal trainer, somebody that will meet with you right before church to buy a cup of coffee, get you a soda, meet with you right in our cafe, get you some french fries, become or something like that. Sit down with you for a couple of weeks. You're not joining some big, long program. Just meet with a friend. Connect in with somebody here at church to teach you personally some things about the Word of God, to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything that God has for you. So if you guys would just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my friend, Pastor Joel. Congratulations. Let's give the Lord a great big praise in the house. Hallelujah.
Woo! Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.